The reason that we're doing this presentation, or the reason I'm doing it today, really has a lot to do with my mission. And I would actually say it's our collective mission, Daniel's and mine, which is to reach as many people as we can, to reach millions of people if we can, and inspire them to achieve vibrant health, whatever that means to them. This is a photo of us from 2006 when we first got together. And we've transformed our own health. And again, our sense of mission is to help you transform yours and anyone else that you meet and can share the information with. So many of you have a health story. In fact, I'd say everyone in this room has a health story. So I'm going to invite you to think about what your health story is, what the things you tell yourself about your health are, and perhaps some of the things that are going to pop up on the screen will be familiar to you. Anybody identify with any of those that pop up there? Part of your health story? So, anybody know what the significance of the number 30,000 is? Any ideas? That's actually the number of days in the average human lifespan. That's the average number of days that you get to be on the planet. So, what are you willing to do to increase the number and the quality of those days that you have left? Hippocrates was credited as saying, healing is a matter of time, but it's also a matter of opportunity, and I'm hoping that this is your opportunity today to start a different health story. So the program that we're going to be going over today, which is our Transformational Health and Detox program, will help you enhance metabolism and excretion of toxins. It will help you implement a healthier diet. It will help you learn about food substances and addictions and dependencies that may come up for you. It will help lower inflammation in your body, understand how stress and coping tools affect your health, and gain tools to transform your health. So that's our purpose. So let's talk about how people make new habits. There's quite a bit of research on this, but first we want to define what habits are. So habits are basically actions that are triggered automatically in response to a context. Automatically washing your hands, for example, is an action that after you use the toilet, which is the context. Putting on a seatbelt action after getting into the car, which is your cue, that context. The research shows that repeating an action in a consistent context leads to the action being activated upon subsequent exposure to that context. Once initiation of the action is transferred to the external cue, the context, there's a decreased need to depend on conscious action or motivation. So, if you want to change something, repeat it in the same context. The goal is permanent change. So, sometimes people take this program and then they revert back to a lot of their old eating patterns and behaviors and coping strategies, but I'm hoping that some of what you're going to learn by going through this program is going to be a permanent change. And here's what the research shows. So, how long does it take for a new habit to form? Well, this is a study with 96 volunteers who chose either a new eating, drinking, or activity behavior to carry out in the same context for about 12 weeks. The average that it took for the people to actually implement that and make it a habit was about 66 days. So missing one opportunity to perform the behavior did not really affect the habit, so you don't have to be perfect. And repetition in a consistent context increased the automaticity of it. So for example, walking at your lunch break, every lunch break, or eating vegetables at dinner, every dinner, drinking water when you go to the bathroom. A lot of people say, I can't because I work, I'm too busy, I'm too highly scheduled, but actually there are studies that show that people who have a schedule do better because again, that's the same context. So how do you create a new habit? A lot of times people say to me, I don't have the motivation to change. And I think motivation is a myth. I think it's about 2% of what you need to change is motivation. The rest is simply a habit, and you can learn to implement a new habit. So step one is pick your goal. For example, I'm very good at goals. I have several for New Year's. And one of them is I want to be able to do a pull-up without assistance. So I have a new, that's my one of my goals. So I talked to my personal trainer and said we need to develop a strategy so that I'll be able to do this. And I texted him recently and said, how about I choose an action that's gonna help me move toward my goal on my own? So I said, what if I do 20 extra push-ups a day with good form? Would that be valuable? And he's like, yes. So that's what I chose. And then plan when and where you will perform this action. So for me, because I'm in my office every single day and that's the contextual cue I'm using, when I enter my office, I get on the ground and do 20 push-ups. So that is gonna help move me toward my goal. Every time you encounter that time and place, perform that action every single time. So I have one patient, every time she goes to the bathroom, she does push-ups on the sink. Great, that's a context and an action. And it does get easier with time. So within about 10 weeks, you're gonna automatically be doing it, whatever the habit is. What else does the research show? Well, the research shows that, unfortunately, sticks work better than carrots. So this is a book that Ian Ayers wrote, and he's one of my heroes. We're going to talk about one of his great websites that you can sign up for at the end. But Ian Ayers is an economist and professor of law at Yale, and he studied how people change. How do they form new habits? And he wrote a book about it called Carrots and Sticks, but I'm going to summarize it for you and save you the time of reading it. And basically that is that that sticks work better than carrots. So in other words, incentives often don't work as well as punishments or fear losing something that you want. So we'll talk about that at the end in a way that you can use that to your advantage now that we know that that's true for a lot of things. So here are my expectations for you joining this program. One is to get honest about where you are now. You know, so often people don't want to know. I call it ostrich syndrome, where they don't actually want to get on the scale. They don't want to do their lab work. They don't want to have to come in and go over their health. So I'm going to expect you to get honest about where you're at. And you can do that with lab work. That gives you information. You can do that by just taking an inventory of your overall health status. You can do that by looking at your BMI. Now, BMI is just a height and weight statistical calculation that tells you whether or not you're overweight. You can be overweight and be healthy if you have a lot of muscle mass. So the BMI has limitations. We do BIA, or body impedance analysis testing, in our office. You are welcome to come and do that testing. That will tell you your fat and muscle percentages. And it's very valuable because, again, you want to lose fat, not muscle or lean body mass. And then you all have a toxicity questionnaire. Did you all get that when you came in? So that, I've used that questionnaire now. I've been doing detox groups for 15 years, and I have used that before and after with hundreds of patients. I will tell you clinically, I see amazing changes from that questionnaire before and after. I don't have a single patient who's gone through the program and not had significant changes. So I started collecting it. I was thinking of publishing it one day, but I got overwhelmed. But I really recommend you fill out that questionnaire. And if you want another one so you can fill it out again when you're done with the program, that would be valuable. We're happy to give it to you or email it to you. Okay, the other aspect that I'm going to expect is that you commit to this program. If you bothered to get up this morning and come here to learn about it, I would recommend that you commit. Part of that commitment means prioritizing your own needs. So during this 21 days, I would suggest that you say no to things that you don't want to do and you say yes to you. I also will expect you to commit to following the elimination diet. Now, not everybody is perfect and 100%. We're going to get questions. We're going to talk about the diet because that brings up a lot for people. Pretty much when you email me, can we have this, can I do this, can I eat this, the answer is always going to be the same. You can eat and do whatever you want. This is your program. My suggestion is you follow the diet that has worked for the most people, but this is your program. So that will probably be the answer pretty much all the time because you can have anything you want. But the diet was developed for a reason and the diet has been clinically studied. So that's why I suggest it. I'm also using a medical food so that you don't get sick as you're detoxifying, so it will support your detoxification pathways. That you read your daily emails. So when you all came in, make sure we have your accurate email address. Daniel's put together an awesome coaching program that you get to enroll in for free. You get a daily email with information about what that day is like and what you might be struggling with and some tips. So make sure we have your email and make sure we have the date at which you're starting the program. Not everybody's going to start tomorrow. And if you need help, ask for it. So if you're my patient, please, if you're struggling, send me a message through the EMR or email Daniel and he'll coach you because we've been doing this for a long time. So please do ask for help if you need it. Okay, so let's talk about toxins. But where do toxins come from in your body? So there are recreational toxins, coffee, alcohol, cigarettes, illegal drugs. So even though marijuana is a plant, it still is an illegal drug in a lot of places, and it still can cause harm to the body. Prescription drugs, self-generated toxins, so hormones are self-generated toxins. Fertilizers, additives like colorings and preservatives, auto emissions, industrial pollutants, and of course pesticides. So how much herbicide, fungicide, and insecticides are used? Well, worldwide in 2007, which was the most recent data I could find, 39.4 billion pounds were used. In the U.S., it was 5.2 billion. In the U.S., it was 12.5 billion. So that's about 3.5 pounds now for every man, woman, and child that is used on our crops. So pesticides are fat soluble, and remember your brain is about 60% fat. So a lot of the time pesticides can be stored in neurological tissue. This is why studies have linked pesticides to depression and mental illness, and also neurological diseases such as Parkinson's, especially in those applying the pesticides. Hormone imbalances, skin, eye, lung problems, and certain cancers, especially breast, pancreatic, prostate, and brain cancers. Let's talk just a little bit about glyphosate. So this isn't a lecture all about Roundup and Monsanto, but you'll hear a lot about it. So what is glyphosate, or glyphosate? It is basically the key ingredient in Roundup. It was introduced in the mid-70s by Monsanto, and it's used to kill weeds by blocking proteins that are essential to the plant's growth. It's now used in 160 countries with 1.4 billion pounds applied yearly. Almost all the corn, soy, and cotton grown in the U.S. is sprayed with glyphosate, or glyphosate, depending on how you pronounce it. And genetically modified seeds make these crops resistant. So this is one of the reasons I recommend to my patients who are on injectable hormones, can we please have it compounded for you in organic grapeseed oil or sesame oil, because all injectable hormones are put in cottonseed oil, and cotton is highly sprayed, and I don't want people injecting that. Also, don't want them eating it. Same thing with soy and corn products, and of course, most of that corn is going to feed livestock. So when a study that was done, which sampled waterways in 38 states, found residue in most of the rivers, streams, ditches, and wastewater treatment plants, 70% of rainfall that was sampled had glyphosate in it, and the residue was detected in about 90% of soybeans. Sorry if I'm depressing you, but this is all a way of saying please eat organic and don't eat those crops. So what about health problems? What do we know? Well, unfortunately, glyphosate is not included in the U.S. government's testing for pesticide residue on food. So we don't know how much of it ends up on our food because it's not tested. It's also not monitored in human blood or tissue samples yet. So there is no information on how much people are exposed to from using it in their yards or living near farms or eating foods from treated fields. We don't know is the answer. The UN International Agency for Research on Cancer has done some studies looking at human, animal, and cell studies. They did find glyphosate in farm workers' blood and urine, chromosomal damage in cells, and an increased risk of non-Hodgkin's lymphoma. Also an increased risk of tumor formation in some animal studies. Okay, so the Environmental Protection Agency has a toxic release inventory program where companies that use chemicals are required to report to. The 2015 data is out. It's going to be published in January of 2017, which is now. So I wasn't able to get the most recent data, so I had to go back to 2009. But basically in 2009, there were 682 toxic chemicals disposed of in the U.S. by companies. About 20,797 companies reported to the TRI. There were 3.37 billion pounds of chemical emissions pumped into the air, released into the ground, and dumped into lakes and rivers. And if you're curious, that's where it's going, the different locations. And you can get that most recent information. It will be worse because every year they add chemicals to the TRI and more companies have to report. So let's talk a little bit about environmental toxins known as endocrine disruptors, because most of you know my passion is hormones, and endocrine disruptors absolutely affect endogenous, meaning made in the body, hormones and how they work. So I want you to know a little bit about how the chemicals in the environment are affecting your hormones. Plus, it's a very common question I get. So commonly patients will ask, well, how come so many people need hormones, or how come there's so many symptoms? My mother never had that. My grandmother never had that. Here's one possible explanation. And it's also an explanation of why sperm counts are going down and fertility is going down in men. So this is a statement published in 2009 from the Endocrine Society. The Endocrine Society is the oldest endocrine society in the world. They're very conservative for the most part, but this was a position paper that they published. It's about 50 pages. You can get a copy of it yourself if you're geeky and want to actually read it. But essentially what they said was that endocrine disruptors affect male and female reproduction, breast development and cancer, prostate cancer, neuroendocrinology, thyroid function, metabolism, obesity, and cardiovascular endocrinology. So this paper is essentially a synthesis of the data up until 2009 in that regard. And here are the key points of the paper, so I'll summarize it for you. Endocrine disrupting substances, EDCs, are substances in our environment, food, or consumer products that interfere with hormone synthesis, metabolism, or activity. Animal models, so that's studies in animals, human clinical observations, and epidemiological studies implicate them as a significant concern to public health. Unfortunately, the effects of these chemicals may be transmitted to further generations through epigenetic modifications. So when women are pregnant, they can transfer this information to their offspring, who can transfer it to their offspring. There's strong, and this is part of the paper also, the key points. There is strong evidence that exposure to these chemicals can cause reproductive problems, so infertility, cancers of the reproductive system, malformations. And there is increasing evidence for effects on other endocrine systems, including thyroid. I would say that's kind of a done deal. We know that endocrine disruptors disrupt thyroid hormone, and that's why so many people are hypothyroid, at least 1 in 10. Neuroendocrine, obesity and metabolism, and insulin and glucose homeostasis. I would say that's also pretty clear now. The Endocrine Society actually made this statement, which I found pretty interesting since they don't tend to get political, and like I said, they're a very conservative organization. We suggest that the Endocrine Society actively engages in lobbying for regulations seeking to decrease human exposure to the many endocrine disrupting chemicals. Pretty bold statement. So there's a growing body of research about endocrine disrupting chemicals being obesogens. So these chemicals, some of them actually disrupt metabolism and affect how you gain weight. Part of the reason that for my weight loss program, I always recommend patients go through this program first. So xenoestrogens, these are molecules in the environment that mimic estrogen in an unhealthy way in a woman's body. And most of them, as you'll notice, are insecticides or pesticides. Some are preservatives. Red dye, PCBs. Notice the two bottom ones, bisphenol A and phthalates. We're going to talk a little bit about bisphenol A and phthalates so you understand what they are. So BPA, bisphenol A, was actually invented in the late 1800s. It started to be used in medicine in the 1930s. It was actually researched as a synthetic estrogen used to help with miscarriage in women. There's over 1.76 billion pounds produced in the US every year, 4 billion pounds worldwide. It's used in polycarbonate plastic and epoxy resins. You're gonna find it in sunglasses, CD cases, water bottles, food containers, the inside lining of cans and pop cans, some dental fillings. And then phthalates are added to plastic to increase the flexibility. So any flexible plastic, like a shower curtain, has phthalates in it. About 800 million pounds a year, 95 to 98% of people tested have phthalates in their urine, so we're all exposed. And they are a known endocrine disruptor, kidney and brain damage in some studies. So they're used as a solvent in perfume and pesticides, nail polish, paint, adhesive caulk, kids' toys. A lot of times you can smell phthalates, you know, the smell of a new, although we got a new shower curtain and it's phthalate-free, but you know how they smell, or rubber boots. Okay, bisphenol A, it's found in about 93% of the population. One recent study where they gave a bunch of Harvard College kids some water bottles and said, drink out of these and we'll measure your urine, they found about 70% of them had BPA levels that were high after only 1 week of drinking out of those water bottles. BPA has been linked to estrogenic activity that can damage the liver, increase breast cancer and prostate risk. Of course, the link between BPA and obesity and diabetes and thyroid problems. Phthalates, again, the shower curtain. And, you know, all those waterproof boots and jackets, nail polish, perfume, that new car smell, that's basically phthalates volatilizing from the car. And anything with a 3 on it has phthalates. So anything with a 7 has BPA, anything with a 3 has phthalates in it. So xenoestrogens, again, have been linked to prostate cancer, testicular cancer, lower sperm count, and BPH in men. And in women, endometriosis, breast cancer, and obesity. There's a wonderful organization called breastcancerfund.org. Check them out. Lots of information about endocrine-disrupting cancers, endocrine-disrupting chemicals, and breast cancer. And that is a receding glacier. Eerily beautiful, isn't it? Okay, so how do you know if you're toxic? How do you know if you're toxic? Anybody have any ideas?
You just told us we're toxic.
Yeah, pretty much you're toxic. You've been paying attention. It's not a matter of if you're toxic. We are all living in a garbage can. We are all like Oscar the Grouch. It's just a matter of what you want to do about it. This was a study that was done in 1970 through 1989 looking at adipose tissue samples, so fat biopsies. 100% of people tested were positive for plastic solvents and dioxins, and this was across the country and different age brackets too. I think they went down to teenagers. So what are some of the symptoms? Well, you have your toxicity questionnaire that you're going to fill out. But some of the most common ones, neuropathy or numbness, memory issues, thinking problems. Some people describe it as foggy thinking. GI issues like bloating, pain, diarrhea, or gas. Immune system problems, getting sick a lot, night sweats and allergies, autoimmune diseases contributing to cancer. Endocrine system issues like heavy periods, breast pain, low libido, erectile dysfunction, inability to lose weight, and thyroid problems. Muscle aching, sort of feeling hungover and toxic all over. And also a lot of skin problems can be from toxicity. So hives, tendency to have MRSA, I've seen that. Itching, acne. The skin is an organ of elimination, so. Let's talk a little bit about inflammation. You've all been hearing a lot about inflammation in the media now. They're talking about inflammation. So what is inflammation? Well, inflammation is just the body's response to an injury or infection. When the inflammatory cascade is started, you'll see an increase in blood flow, heat, pain, redness, and swelling. That's with acute inflammation. And that's good because inflammation saves your life. So if you get bit by a dog and it's a terrible bite, for example, you want the inflammatory process to kick in right away, because what's going to happen is that area that's damaged is going to become isolated. White blood cells are going to be brought to the area to fight any infection that could be brewing or any bacteria that we were exposed to, and then the healing is promoted. So this is really good. You want this in an acute situation. This is one of the reasons those of you who are my patient, when we measure your CRP levels, your high sensitivity CRP, I always recommend you don't do it if you've been sick recently or had an injury, because we want to see what the inflammation is in your body, but not from acute purposes. Because it's the chronic hidden inflammation that's so detrimental. This is associated with allergies, asthma, autoimmune issues, pain conditions, heart disease, diabetes, dementia, and Alzheimer's, and cancers. All of these are associated with inflammation. And mainly there are four areas that contribute to increased inflammation: stress, toxicity, poor diet and lifestyle, and obesity. Oftentimes these overlap. But fat tissue is an endocrine organ. In fact, fat tissue makes more a hormone than any tissue of your body. The more fat you have, the more inflammation you make. So fat is an endocrine organ. And during this program, you will lower your inflammation. Part of the whole purpose here. So let's talk about the key players that are involved in detoxification and elimination. The lungs through breathing, the skin through sweating, your kidneys obviously through formation of urine, your GI tract, so your gallbladder, and then elimination through the feces, and then your liver. But we are going to talk about supporting your liver. This is critical. So a lot of people will ask me, well, where's my liver and how big it is? If you want to know how big your liver is, take your hand, put it up at the end of your rib cage, and cross the midline, because your liver's huge. It's about that big in most people. And your liver is one of the only organs, if not the only organ, that can completely regenerate. You can lose half your liver and grow a new liver and survive. The liver is tremendous. And there's two main pathways in your liver that are responsible for detoxification. So initially what happens is a fat-soluble toxin, like BPA or phthalates, is turned into an active intermediate through phase one. We're going to talk a little bit about phase one for those of you who want to geek out about this. And then that active intermediate is conjugated to something, usually glucuronic acid or something like that, to make it a water-soluble compound so you can excrete it. So this is a two-step process. So phase one, this is your first line of defense. Everything you eat or ingest goes right to your liver. So it all goes to the liver first. This is your very first line of defense, is phase one activities. So this is how you detoxify pesticides, herbicides, pollutants, solvents, pharmaceuticals. Endogenous means made in the body, waste products, all goes through the liver, all starts at phase one. And you can have genetic polymorphisms in the phase one enzymes. And so this is something that we can test for. Those are the main polymorphisms that affect a lot of different things if you have them genetically. And you know, I was putting together this presentation, or I was updating it, and of course, you know how you're online and you're reading things, or you think of things and you go look it up, because it's very hard to just be linear about something like this. And so I started thinking about defense, and I was thinking about Refrigerator Perry. Does anybody remember Refrigerator Perry? So I grew up in Chicago, and I remember Super Bowl 20 in the 1980s when Refrigerator Perry was the best defensive lineman in the world, right? He was huge, and that's why they called him Refrigerator Perry. So I just Googled him to see, well, what's going on with Refrigerator Perry now? So especially since he was everybody's hero. So there's a picture of number 72, Refrigerator Perry. And sadly, most likely because of the number of head injuries that he suffered and encephalopathy, he is about 425 pounds now. He ended up with Guillain-Barré in 2008 and became wheelchair-bound, and he's diabetic and an alcoholic and is scheduled potentially to actually have his leg amputated. So there's my little plug about why football is so horrible, except for I didn't know this about him until I started looking up the best defensive lineman I could think of. Sorry to bum you all out. Okay, back to cytochrome P450 SNPs, or polymorphisms that you can have. So if you have a genetic SNP in 1A2, this metabolizes caffeine. So oftentimes I'll tell my patients, you know, there's actually a gene that could predispose you to an increased risk of a heart attack from drinking coffee, because some people think it's okay to drink 6 cups of coffee a day. Well, in one study, people who had one of these SNPs, they had 36% increased risk of a heart attack with 3 cups a day. If they were a really slow metabolizer and had two SNPs, they actually had a 64% increased risk of an MI if they drank 4 cups of coffee a day. 1B1, a SNP in that, that's responsible for 4-hydroxylation of estrogens and activation of polycyclic aromatic hydrocarbons, which are molecules that are produced from cigarette smoke and when you grill food, which is why you shouldn't grill food. Because they're known carcinogens. If you have a 2C9 SNP, that metabolizes many drugs. 2D6 metabolizes about a quarter of all drugs. And 3A4 metabolizes at least 50% of drugs, including all hormones. So this is one of the reasons if somebody genetically has that SNP, they may need actually less hormone because they can't metabolize it. Okay, phase two. So remember, there was the phase one. Those are the cytochrome P450 family enzymes. And then there's phase two, which is conjugation and elimination. And don't worry, we're almost done with the biochemistry if you're getting bored. So there's four main aspects to phase two. Methylation, you can actually test for COMT SNPs. Acetylation, glutathione conjugation, and oxidative protection. So what's methylation? Well, methylation is responsible for metabolizing catecholamines. These are neurotransmitters like dopamine, epinephrine, and norepinephrine. And if you have that SNP, it can predispose you toward anxiety, ADHD, alcoholism, and rapid cycling in bipolar people. If you have an N-acetyltransferase SNP, that detoxifies many environmental toxins, and slow or rapid acetylation, you can have an increased risk of certain forms of cancer, such as lung, colon, bladder, head and neck cancers. Glutathione, the master detoxifier. When I test patients, I'd say about 75% of them have low glutathione. And glutathione is important for detoxifying many water-soluble toxins, and defects actually can lead to many different increased risks for cancers. Superoxide dismutase, this is the master antioxidant enzyme. Of course, you will have more free radical damage if you have a SNP in this, and an increased risk of developing neurodegenerative disorders, and also, I would say, accelerated aging. Okay, suboptimal liver function. What happens when your liver is not functioning well? Well, this is because of slow or incomplete detoxification, so you could be genetically predisposed, and you will increase the storage of toxins. Toxins are stored in fat tissue, as we already talked about, including your brain and central nervous system. Stored toxins are released slowly, so they can contribute to many illnesses and symptoms of chronic illness. Why does the liver get overwhelmed? Why would that happen? There are too many toxins, right? It's not a matter of if you're toxic, it's how toxic you are and what you want to do about it, because we're all living in a garbage can. We just talked about the genetics. Constipation. So if you are not pooping at least once a day, preferably two, or if you eat three meals three times a day, so that is the definition of constipation. I know the conventional world says you can go 3 to 5 days without a bowel movement and that's normal. That's not normal. It's a tube. When something goes in, something should come out, just like with babies. So if you are not pooping regularly, you can have what's called enterohepatic recirculation of toxins. So the toxins that are excreted from the bile into the intestine can end up being deconjugated if you have bad gut microbes, and then reabsorbed and recirculated. So sometimes women can have low estrogen, for example, but yet they have symptoms of estrogen dominance because of enterohepatic recirculation. And this can happen with many toxins. So you need to poop every day, at least once a day. If you have bad microbiome, so you have 10 times more bacteria in your GI tract than you do cells in your body. You are actually walking around, carrying around 10 times more bacteria in your gut than cells in your body, which is sort of creepy when you think about it. Well, these bacteria are like an organ. They actually have huge function. One of them is to make sure that you're detoxifying and excreting things properly. If you don't have enough nutrients, the vitamins, minerals, and amino acids you need for phase one and phase two activity, which is why fasting on water is probably not a good idea. And then if you have increased intestinal permeability, otherwise known as leaky gut, this can overwhelm the liver. So what is leaky gut? Anyone heard that term before? That term, I don't know why that term just triggers me. It sounds so icky. I prefer the term increased intestinal permeability, but leaky gut is probably more, you get a picture, yeah. So this is a section of the colon, and notice the dense villi that are actually surrounding the entire lumen of the colon. That's where you absorb nutrients, by the way. So this is just a single villi blown up, so you could see it. So the epithelial cells that line this villi are held together with tight junctions. What can happen is that they can start to separate. If they separate, whole molecules leak into the bloodstream. The body creates antibodies to these molecules. This is part of the way that food allergies develop. Also, it promotes inflammation because there's foreign invaders. In fact, they have found bacteria that live in the gums and the GI tract inside coronary plaque. So part of the way it gets there is that if you have leaky gut, you upregulate LDL, because LDL has receptors for the lipopolysaccharide and the cell wall membrane of the bacteria. It is all one. So this is why we always start with the gut. And if you have leaky gut, it can cause autoimmune disease. It can contribute to high LDL, dementia, and cancer risk. So this is, again, the purpose of this program isn't just to do a detox, it's actually to heal your gut. And you can have a brand new GI lining by the time you finish this program. So if your routes of elimination are not functioning smoothly, for example, you get constipated, you have liver disease to start with, you have asthma or kidney disease, please see me privately and I will help you, because you'll want to be monitored through a program like this to make sure you don't get sick. Okay, so what is healthy and safe detoxification? What does that involve? It is not fasting. So water, juice, or otherwise, this is not necessarily, thank you, healthy detoxification. Fasting can lead to leaky gut, especially if it's more than 3 days, because you've deprived your gut of glutamine, which it needs to keep those cells together. Fasting can also damage your metabolism, long-term fasting, because it suppresses your thyroid. And it deprives the body of nutrients and amino acids that you need for complete elimination of toxins. So I don't recommend fasting for longer than 1 or 2 days if you're going to fast. So our program, when I came up with how to think about this program, has three elements to it. The first is to reduce exposure, thank you. The second is to support detoxification, and the third is to enhance the elimination of toxins. So we'll start by talking about what does reduce exposure mean? This means avoid recreational substances. All the bookends, the coffee and the alcohol, right? What the coping things. If you can, it might be a time to stop smoking if you are a smoker. If this is too difficult, then I would suggest not stopping smoking while you go through a program like this. Please don't stop your prescription medications, although if you're not my patient, please talk to your doctor, because you can rapidly drop your blood sugar if you're eating a lot healthier, and if you're an insulin-dependent diabetic, that could affect your health, or you might lower your blood pressure medication. So talk to your doctor. Okay, reduced exposure also means drink clean water, 2 liters a day, preferably from glass bottles. Clean air, this is a no-brainer. If you smell chemicals, they're getting in your body. So if it doesn't smell like clean air, it's not. Clear your mind. This is a wonderful opportunity to shift your thoughts through meditation or prayer, journaling, listening to visualization CDs, although we used to give out CDs with this program, but I don't think anyone has a CD player anymore. And slowing down, give yourself the opportunity to actually do one thing at a time and be more mindful during this 21 days and slow down. This is one of my favorite Randy Glassbergen cartoons. Can you all read it? There's no peace, there's no picture and no sound. It's the Peace and Quiet channel. This is what we watch at my house. Okay, sleep. If I have to convince you to sleep, lack of sleep has been linked to a lot of health problems. 7 to 9 hours a night is what most people need. A lot of times I need 9. If you don't wake rested, you probably didn't sleep enough. So give yourself permission to sleep. Now let's talk a little bit about food. And these are some broad categories, but I really wanted Ronald McDonald to say something positive. You literally become what you eat and what you digest and absorb. It would be helpful if you started to think of food as information. So the food is fuel mindset, shift that into food as information mindset. And here's how it's information. So the genes that you inherit from your parents, you can think of that as your book of life. Food actually provides the signaling substances that tell the genes what to do. This is why you are not your genes, you are how your genes express themselves. Food determines the stories from the chapters that are read in your book of life. You may have a genetically increased risk for some forms of cancer, however, you won't get cancer if you eat certain foods and give the information to the body that's different than what somebody else might give the information. And this is just a picture of how genes interact with your environment to form what we call your phenotype, which is you. So you are not your genes, that is not your health destiny, that is just information, and the food you provide and the toxins you avoid affect that outcome. So the elimination diet that I suggest you follow as part of this program, you all got a copy of it. You will avoid common food allergens. You'll avoid inflammatory foods. Avoid excess toxins. So think about this. The higher on the food chain, the more toxins are stored in that animal, especially if it has a lot of fat. I suggest you eat organic produce. We've already talked ad nauseum about pesticides and herbicides. Free-range meat. So if you think about it, cows that are marbled that are so delicious, the reason they're so delicious is because they pretty much have diabetes. So they're given so much corn that it makes them fat and it marbles the meat. That's what happens to humans when fat actually starts getting deposited in your muscle tissue. You get marbled. So I would suggest you don't eat those animals. These are some high heavy metal fish to avoid, and this tends to change, so I can send you out a link if you want to check with that. But for the most part, these are the fish you'll want to avoid. Always avoid Chilean sea bass for the rest of your life. It's endangered. And tuna, especially the big tunas, because they tend to have higher heavy metals than small tuna. And the Environmental Working Group, is anyone familiar with the Environmental Working Group? They're such a great organization. They test produce in the country every year, and they put out their Dirty Dozen. So this is the 2016 Dirty Dozen. These are the most pesticide residue found pieces of produce, so you'll want to make sure you eat these organically. You'll notice that a lot of them are fruit, because fruit is sweet, of course, attracts a lot of pesticides, a lot of bugs, and so they're highly sprayed. So you'll want to make sure, if you don't have the budget to eat organically for everything, that you at least eat these 14 things organically. These are the clean 15, so these are the 15 least sprayed with the fewest or least amount of pesticide residue of what they tested. Avocados, corn kind of surprised me, although most corn is GMO now in this country, so you still want to eat it organically if you want to eat non-GMO. So all organic produce is non-GMO. There are 29 million pounds of antibiotics used in livestock in 2009. That's because they tend to get infections because they're fed garbage and put in pretty small quarters. So you'll want to make sure you're not contributing to that antibiotic resistance, which is what can end up happening in humans because of that, by making sure that you eat free range and organic meat. Get really picky. I actually had a patient say almost this exact thing once, except for it was a salad. Don't tell me to eat a salad. I ate one and I didn't feel any different. So this is something that you're going to need to do on an ongoing day by day. Okay, so we talked about reducing exposure. Let's talk about supporting detoxification. That means supporting your liver and your gut. This is the formula we use and that we've had the most success with. We call it our metabolic recovery formula. It's hypoallergenic, high in protein. It has all the nutrients, amino acids, and herbs needed for phase 1 and phase 2 support. It helps lower inflammation, and I use it to help heal leaky gut. So this is what we use in addition to the diet. When it comes to the second aspect, I do suggest people take a probiotic now in addition to using the metabolic recovery formula. So what is a probiotic? You may have heard this term before. Pro means promoting, and biotic means life. So these are live organisms that benefit health. Where are they found? Well, they're found naturally in fermented food, which I suggest you eat every day because this helps feed the good bugs, the microbiome. Also, you can take a probiotic, and of course, they're found in your GI tract. Now, if you take a probiotic, this is like a seed. I don't want you to think, oh, well, I take a probiotic, I'm fine. You're taking a seed. You have to feed the seed. So we used to think if you took a probiotic, it would actually adhere to the gut lining and change everything. And we now know that was way too simplistic. There are at least 1,200 different species of organisms that live in your gut. The key to health over and over in the research is that the more diverse your microbiome, the better. So the more organisms you have, the better. How do you get a diverse microbiome? You take a probiotic and you feed the probiotic. And what do you feed it? What do the good bugs love? So people who are my patients, what do the good bugs love? Vegetables, fiber. Good bugs love fiber and fermented food. That's what makes them grow. So we're talking about fruits and vegetables, beans, legumes, nuts, seeds. We're not talking about a ton of grains. And the type of bacteria that you have in your gut, for those of you who struggle with your weight, perk up. We've actually found that there are fat bugs and skinny bugs. So there are certain types of bacteria that live in your gut that actually, when transferred to another person, may influence their weight. We've seen this in mice. So bugs taken out of fat mice, put in skinny mice, get fat. Fed the same exact diet. Why would that be? Because that determines how many calories you extract from food, which explains why some people can eat the exact same diet, one person loses more weight, one doesn't. Also plays a role in your brain chemistry. So remember, you have 10 times more bacteria in your gut than you do cells in your body. Those bacteria create neurotransmitters. So they are influencing your cravings. Guess what feeds the fat bugs, the bacteria that tend to promote weight gain?
Sugar,
trans fat, yeah, saturated fat. So this research that's coming out on the microbiome is fascinating when it comes to weight. So think about that. When you go to eat something, do you want to feed your fat bugs or your skinny bugs? Because you want that skinny bug microbiome. And shifting your microbiome takes a long time. So it's not something you do in one detox. It's a mindset that you're going to do the rest of your life. Okay, what are the benefits of probiotics? So this is what the research has shown, is that probiotics help improve nutrient absorption. They can help with gas and bloating and constipation. They improve digestion of lactose, especially if you take the probiotic when you're introducing lactose, then it'll induce that tolerance to lactose. Because they can crowd out the bad bugs and also create hydrogen peroxide, they're actually harmful at preventing bacterial infections and pathogens. So those of you who travel a lot, if you tend to get traveler's diarrhea, if you take a probiotic regularly and you're feeding that probiotic healthy food, you're much less likely to get that. A better immune function and fewer illnesses, because those bacteria play a role in immune function. Alleviation of food and environmental allergies, which start in the gut. And reduced infections like yeast infections and UTIs. This is the probiotic that I recommend for most people. So there's different organisms. I like this one because there's tons of research behind the strains that we've chosen to put in this. So for the average person, this is the best probiotic. Now sometimes I use different ones for different reasons, but this is the one I would suggest as part of the detox. It's got 30 billion organisms per capsule, so you don't need to be taking several capsules a day. You just want to take one. Okay, let's talk about enhancing elimination. So we talked about how do you reduce exposure, how do you support your liver and your gut in elimination. Now we're going to talk about other ways to help with elimination. Well, you can do dry skin brushing or massage therapy. This helps with lymphatic drainage, and it's wonderful. Saunas. We have an infrared sauna, and we're happy to give you info if you're interested in getting yourself an infrared sauna, because we love ours. Saunas increase blood supply to the skin, so you're actually excreting more toxins that way. And exercise. So, those of you who don't exercise at all and are sedentary, you may just want to use your pedometer. Everybody has one on their phone now. All phones have pedometers, or jump rope, or something. Does anybody remember Newton's first law? Yep, the law of inertia, body at rest stays at rest. And this is why it can be so hard if you don't exercise to exercise, because a body at rest stays at rest, and a body in motion stays in motion. This is why you need to do it every 24 to 48 hours. And this is my very favorite Randy Glassbergen cartoon, because I hear it a lot. People are too busy to exercise, even though we're talking about maybe 30 minutes a day. And it's better than the alternative, right? Okay. Excellent transit time. You want to have 1 to 3 bowel movements a day. If you are not and you become constipated, I can help you with that. 2 liters of water a day, preferably out of clear glass bottles. Deep abdominal breathing, so thinking about elimination through breathing. And here's a review of what you're going to do. You're going to enhance metabolism and excretion of toxins, implement a healthier diet, learn about food substances, addictions, and dependencies, lower inflammation, understand how stress and coping tools affect your health, and gain tools to transform your health. Remember, I have some expectations about you. One is that you're honest about where you are now and that you commit. And here's some resources. So I'll go through them briefly. If one of them piques your interest, please circle it so you remember to go back to it. I like stickk.com. So this is Ian Ayer's program that he developed. It's absolutely free, and I think he's so generous to be offering this to people. This is a website where you pick a goal, and if you're serious about change, I suggest you pick a goal that you're going to stick to for 3 weeks, 21 days, because that's about how long it'll take for you to implement it as a habit. So you pick your goal. For example, I'm going to do one pull-up by the end of 2017, although my trainer says we'll do it in a month, so I like that better. And then you pick your wager. So let's, and make it hurt. I'm not talking $5. Let's say $50, $100, $500, depends on how serious you are. And because Ian Ayers is a lawyer, in addition to being a behavioral economic, he has created this website so that it's a legally binding contract. So you log in, you pick your goal, you pick your wager, $500 a week, you pick your support, and somebody that is going to get an email in addition to you saying, Catherine, did you actually do what you needed to do to get toward your goal this week? Yes or no? If I put yes, my sponsor gets an email that says, Catherine said that she did this for a week. Did she? Yes or no? So you see the layers of protection and accountability, right? If you say no, here's the catch. Because remember, carrots don't work as well as sticks. So you pick an anti-charity, an organization that you hate. And when I go through this patience, I say, name it, because you know it. You know it. It's right there. If you say no and you don't reach your goal that week, your wager goes as a donation in your name to your anti-charity. Right? It's genius. He has helped millions of people lose weight, stop smoking, change spending habits, because everybody has good intentions. In this room right now, you're all like, yes, I'm fired up. I'm going to do the detox. It's going to be easy. But then somebody has a glass of wine they offer you, or cake, or whatever your toxin is. And you say, you know, not that big a deal. I'm really not that committed anyway. I'm just going to go ahead and do it. But then you say, screw that. $500 is not going in my name to Donald Trump's fund. Hallelujah. As a donation. I'm not going to have the cake. So it's really a layer of accountability. So I suggest you check out stickk.com. Shrinkyourself.com. So those of us who are emotional eaters, which are most of the people in this room, I imagine, sometimes when you go on a more restricted diet, which, by the way, you're choosing, of course, you can change it at any time, or you could choose not to have that diet, but sometimes it will bring things up because you have emotional dependencies on your food. So shrinkyourself.com was started by a psychologist, and he did some research at UCLA looking at whether or not cognitive behavioral therapy, which is therapy with a trained therapist, was more effective than a computer-based program that had the same goal of CBT, which means in understanding your triggers and translating that into a different activity. And what Roger Gould found was that the computer program was as effective as the one-on-one therapy, significantly cheaper and in some ways more effective, because people were sometimes more honest with a computer than they were with another person. So this program, shrinkyourself.com, is his program that he developed based on his research at UCLA. I've used it with a lot of patients. I've used it myself. I found it really valuable. So he gives you different activities, and then you report back. So check out shrinkyourself.com. He even has like an app for your phone. So the environmentalworkinggroup.org is a great place to get inspired and to learn more about toxins in the environment. Mark Hyman's website, drhyman.com. Mark Hyman is a functional medicine doc who changed his life because he was sick. And he has a lot of information about detoxification on his website. He has a lot of great recipes. So those of you who really want recipes, check out his website and his cookbooks. Same with David Perlmutter. David Perlmutter is a neurologist, and his website has a lot of recipes also, good recipes. The Headspace app. Is anyone using this app yet? Oh, you used it? It's only 10 minutes. So those of you who cringe at the thought of meditation, I'll do it if it's 10 minutes, right? And it's a lovely British man talking to you. So check out the Headspace app. It's free for the first 10 sessions. And then the MyFitnessPal app, those of you who are my patients know about this app because I love it, because it's also free. And you can scan your food, it uploads your food, or you can enter your food and start learning more about your calorie intake, your fiber intake, and things like that. So those are some good resources. So let's just review the program. Detoxification happens on many levels. Every time I go through this program, and I've been doing it for 15 years, I have ahas, usually several ahas. And they're at different levels. So keep that in mind. You're cleansing your body, which is fundamental, but you may be doing detoxification in other ways. Reducing exposure to toxins means avoiding alcohol and chemicals and following the elimination diet. And try and lower your stress. So avoid what you can. You know, say no when you can. Use relaxation tools. Use the Headspace app. Heart math, if you have a heart math. Sleep 7 to 9 hours a night. A lot is happening when you sleep. Aim for your 10,000 steps or some form of exercise. Use your detox support. And then make sure you're drinking enough water, using saunas if you have access to them, and making sure you have excellent transit time. Okay, questions. I know that was fast. Yes. What if you don't have a gallbladder? Great question. So the purpose of the gallbladder is just a little sac that holds bile. So bile is made by the liver, and it backs up into the gallbladder, and the gallbladder just holds it so that if you have a meal with a lot of fat, it contracts and helps you emulsify the fat to be able to absorb it. If you don't have a gallbladder, the liver just drip, drip, drips the bile into the intestines kind of throughout the day, certainly more when you eat. So what I would say is if you don't have a gallbladder, there's no reason you can't do a detox. if you don't have a gallbladder, you may notice you can't eat as much fat at one meal, which is probably not a bad thing. If you know you have gallstones, this is another reason I don't recommend fasting, because you don't want to precipitate a gallbladder attack, but it's fine. Yeah, good question. Anybody else have questions? Anybody scared? Nobody's scared.
A little.
Thank you. Yeah, thank you for being honest. I get scared when I'm going to do this. You know, last night, knowing you were going to go on a detox, how many people are like, I'm having extra champagne tonight? Yeah, yeah, because I can't have this tomorrow, right? I have never had anybody who's gone through this program regret it. I've never had anybody say, I wish I hadn't done that. In fact, people are completely surprised by the time they're done at how good they feel and wonder why on earth they were using all these coping tools before. It's just a habit. So when you build a new habit. Now, most people do not eat this elimination diet 24/7. A lot of my patients say they do, and they don't. I don't. Maybe 85 to 90%. So when you're done with a detox diet, this is a good foundation for a healthy diet. You know, and if you're getting a B plus, A minus, that's good. You know? Anybody else scared? Okay, nobody has questions? What about,
what
can we give up?
Brushing? I know what
dry skin brushing? So that's just using a brush, a bristle brush, and moving toward the heart to help with lymphatic drainage. Because your lymphatic system's right underneath the skin, and you really want to move things toward, for, you know, to keep circulation going. And also, of course, exercise helps with lymphatic drainage.
Yeah.
What about coffee?
Coffee.
Yeah, remember, a lot of people have that SNP, and they don't metabolize coffee very well, and it increases MI risk. Probably it's affecting the endothelium, I don't know. So green tea is a great alternative, and green tea has L-theanine in it, which tends to dampen the effect of caffeine, so usually people don't get jittery on green tea. And green tea has so many health benefits, so green tea is fine on the detox.
The taste factor, not even comparable.
Yeah, I mean, coffee and green tea are not the same. I've tried many other products over the years, like the coffee substitutes, and the root products like chicory root. I like Inca. It's hard to find, but it's instant. And Inca to me is the most coffee-like. I mean, there's Cafix. Tastes a little bit like coffee. You're not going to find anything that tastes like coffee that's not coffee. If you have headaches, that's when you don't drink coffee. That's information about your coffee dependency. And I would suggest cutting down slowly. So maybe if you're a 4-cup a day, you're going to go to 2 cups a day. Or you're going to go to 1 cup a day. Because you don't want to end up taking a bunch of Tylenol, which depletes glutathione in your liver, or taking a bunch of ibuprofen, which messes up your gut and increases leaky gut. You don't want to end up doing that to try to get off the coffee. So.
Well, not only that, you want to make sure you're drinking organic coffee, first of all, right?
Absolutely, yeah.
Because it's one of the most highly pesticide beans on the planet.
I don't know. Is it highly sprayed?
You can also do half and half.
Mm.
Do the decaf.
Half decaf?
Sure, it's the water.
Water processed?
Yeah, water processed. So
that's a good call.
That's what I've done.
Yeah, I got pretty depressed reading about glyphosate and grapes because I have a wine habit that I'm shifting for the next 21 days, and they're highly sprayed. So I don't know how much we're drinking, but the champagne that we have for right now is organic from non-sprayed grapes. I just thought I would tell you that. Yeah, I don't know if it's any good, but. Okay, so make sure we have all of your emails if you want to be part of the coaching program and get those emails. And if you have questions, you can direct them to Daniel while you're going through the process. Or if you're my patient and you have questions about your own health, you can send them through the EMR. And we're going to serve some champagne, and we'll answer more questions if you have them over at our office. Thank you all for coming.
Thanks, Kat.
Yeah.
Thanks again.